Chief Justice Roberts, senators, counsel for the White House, I am Val Demings from the state of Florida. The House managers strongly support the amendment to issue subpoena for documents to the State Department. As we explain, the first article of impeachment charges the president with using the power of his office to solicit and pressure Ukraine to announce investigations that everyone in this chamber knows to be bogus. The president didn't even care if an investigation was actually conducted, just that it was announced. Why? Because this was for his own personal and political benefit. The first article further charges that the president did so with corrupt motives, and that his use of power for personal gain harmed the national security of the United States. As the second article of impeachment charges, the president sought to conceal evidence of this conduct. He did so by ordering his entire administration, every office, every agency, every official, to defy every subpoena served in the House impeachment inquiry. No president in history has ever done anything like this. Many presidents have expressly acknowledged that they couldn't do anything like this. President Trump did not take these extreme steps to hide evidence of his innocence or to protect the institution of the presidency. As a career law enforcement officer, I have never seen anyone take such extreme steps to hide evidence allegedly proving his innocence. And I do not find that here today. The president is engaged in this cover-up because he is guilty, and he knows it. And he knows that the evidence he is concealing will only further demonstrate his culpability. Notwithstanding this effort to stonewall our inquiry, the House amassed powerful evidence of the president's high crimes and misdemeanors. 17 witnesses, 130 hours of testimony combined with the president's own admissions on phone calls and in public comments, confirmed and corroborated by hundreds of texts, emails, and documents. Much of that evidence came from patriotic, nonpartisan, decorated officials in the State Department. They are brave men and women who honored their obligations under the law and gave testimony required by congressional subpoena in the face of the president's taunts and insults. These officials described the president's campaign to induce and pressure Ukraine to announce political investigations, his use of $391 million of vital military aid, taxpayer money appropriated on a bipartisan basis by Congress as leverage to force Ukraine to comply, and his withholding of a meeting desperately sought by the newly elected president of Ukraine. This testimony was particularly compelling because the State Department is at the very center of President Trump's wrongdoing. We heard firsthand from diplomatic officials who saw up close and personal what was happening and who immediately sounded the alarms. Ambassador William Taylor, who returned to Ukraine in June of last year as acting ambassador, texted other State Department officials, "I think it's crazy to withhold security assistance for help with a political campaign. Ambassador to the European Union, Gordon Sondland, who was delegated authority over Ukraine matters by none other than President Trump, testified, "We knew these investigations were important to the president, and we followed the president's orders." And David Holmes, a senior official at the U.S. Embassy in Kyiv, said it was made clear that some action on a Burisma Biden investigation was a condition for an Oval Office meeting. During their testimony, many of these State Department officials described specific documents, including text messages, emails, former diplomatic cables, and notes that would corroborate their testimony and shed additional light on President Trump's corrupt scheme. For instance, Ambassador Taylor, who raised concerns that military aid had been conditioned on the president's demand for political investigations, described a little notebook in which he would take notes on conversations he had with key officials. Ambassador Sondland referred by date and recipient to emails regarding the president's demand that Ukraine announce political investigations. As we'll see through emails that were sent to some of President Trump's top advisors, including acting White House Chief of Staff Mick Mulvaney, Secretary of State Michael Pompeo, and Secretary of Energy Rick Perry. Deputy Assistant Secretary of State George Kent, who oversaw Ukraine policy matters in Washington for the State Department, wrote at least four memos to file to document concerning conduct he witnessed or heard. And Ambassador Kurt Volker, the special representative for Ukraine negotiations, provided evidence that he and other American officials communicated with high-level Ukrainian officials, including President Zelensky himself, via text message and WhatsApp, about the president's improper demands and how Ukrainian officials would respond to them. Based on the testimony we received and on evidence that has since emerged, all of these documents and others that we will describe bear directly on the allegations set forth in the first article of impeachment. They would help complete our understanding of how the president's scheme unfolded in real time. They would support the conclusion that senior Ukrainian officials understood the corrupt nature of President Trump's demand, and they would further expose the extent to which Secretary Pompeo, Acting Chief of Staff Mick Mulvaney, and other senior Trump administration officials were aware of the president's plot and helped carry it out. We're not talking about a burdensome number of documents. We are talking about a specific, discrete set of materials held by the State Department. Documents the State Department has already collected in response to our subpoena, but has never produced. We know these materials exist. We know they are relevant, and we know the president is desperately trying to conceal them. As I will describe, the Senate should subpoena the following. Number one, WhatsApp and other text message communications. Two, emails. Three, diplomatic cables. And four, notes. Given the significance and relevance of these documents, the House requested that they be provided. When these requests were denied, the House issued subpoenas commanding that the documents be turned over. At the president's direction, The Department of State unlawfully defied that subpoena. And I stand here now. As I stand here now, the State Department has all these documents in its possession, but refuses, based on the president's order, to let them see the light of day. This is an affront to the House, which has full power to see these documents. It is an affront to the Senate, which has been denied a full record on which to judge the president's guilt or innocence, and it is an affront to the Constitution, which makes clearly that nobody, not even the president, is above the law. And it is an affront to the American people, who have a right to know what the president and his allies are hiding from them and why it is being hidden. In prior impeachment trials, this body has issued subpoenas requiring the recipient to hand over relevant documents. It must do so again here. And it must do so now at the beginning of the trial, not the end. Of course, the need for a Senate subpoena arises because, as I've noted, the president ordered the State Department to defy a subpoena from the House. At this point, I'd like to briefly describe our own efforts to get those materials. I'll then address in a more detailed fashion exactly what documents the State Department has hidden from the American people and why the Senate should require it to turn them over. On September 9th, exercising their Article I oversight authority, the House Investigating Committee sent a document request to the State Department. The committee sought materials related to the president's effort to pressure Ukraine to announce investigations into his political rival, as well as his dangerous, unexplained withholding of millions of dollars in vital military aid. After the State Department failed to produce any documents, the House Committee on Foreign Affairs issued a subpoena to the State Department on September 27th. In a letter on October 1st, Secretary Pompeo acknowledged receipt of the subpoena. At that time, he stated that he would respond to the committee's subpoena for documents by the return date, October 4th. But his response never came. Instead, on October 8th, President Trump's lawyer, writing on the president's behalf, issued a direction confirming that the administration would stonewall the impeachment inquiry. To date, the State Department has not produced a single document, not a single document in response to the congressional subpoena. But witnesses who testified indicated that the State Department had gathered all of the records and was prepared to provide them before the White House directed it to defy the subpoena. Notwithstanding this unlawful obstruction, through the testimony of brave State Department employees, the House was able to identify with remarkable precision several categories of documents relevant to the first article of impeachment that are sitting right now. Those documents are sitting right now at the State Department. I'd like to walk you through four key categories of documents that should be subpoenaed and which illustrate the highly relevant documents the State Department could produce immediately. They could produce them immediately for this trial. The first category consists of WhatsApps and other text messages from State Department officials caught up in these events, including Ambassadors Sondland and Taylor, and also Deputy Assistant Secretary George Kent, all three of whom confirm in their testimony that they regularly use WhatsApp to communicate with each other and foreign government officials. As Deputy Assistant Secretary Ken explained, WhatsApp is a dominant form of electronic communication in certain parts of the world. We know that the State Department possesses the records of WhatsApp and text messages from critical eyewitnesses to these proceedings, including from Ambassador Sondland and Taylor and Deputy Assistant Secretary Kent. We know that the department is deliberately concealing these records at the direction of the president, and we know that they could contain highly relevant testimony about the president's plan to condition official presidential acts on the announcements of investigations for his own personal and political gain. We know this not only from testimony, but also because Ambassador Volker was able to provide us with a small but telling selection of his WhatsApp messages. Those records confirm with a full review of these texts and WhatsApp messages from relevant officials would help to paint a vivid, firsthand picture of statements, decisions, concerns, and beliefs held by important players of events unfolding in real time. For example, thanks to Ambassador Volker's messages, we know that Ambassador Sondland, a key player in the president's pressure campaign, who testified in the House about a quid pro quo arrangement, texts directly with the Ukrainian president, President Zelensky. This image, produced by Ambassador Volker, appears to be a screenshot of a text message that Ambassador Sondland exchanged with President Zelensky about plans for the White House visit, the very same visit that President Zelensky badly needed, and that President Trump later withheld as part of the quid pro quo described by Ambassador Sondland in his testimony. This body and the American people have a right to know what else Ambassador Sondland and President Zelensky said in this and other relevant exchanges about the White House meeting or about the military aid and the president's demand. But we don't know exactly what was conveyed and when. We don't know if President Trump directed the State Department to conceal these vital records. These are records that the State Department would have otherwise turned over if not for the president's direction and desire to cover up his wrongdoing. To get a sense of why texts and WhatsApp messages are so vital, just consider whether another piece of evidence we've gleaned from Ambassador Volker's partial production. On July 10th, at the White House meetings, at which Ambassador Sondland pressured Ukrainian officials to announce investigations of President Trump's political opponents, a Ukrainian governmental official texted Ambassador Volker, "I feel that the key for many things is Rudy, and I am ready to talk with him at any time." This is evidence that immediately following Ambassador Sondland's ultimatum, Ukrainian officials recognized that they needed to appease Rudy Giuliani by carrying out the investigations. Of course, Mr. Giuliani had publicly confirmed that he was not engaged in foreign policy, but it was instead advancing his clients, the president's own personal interest. Further, in another text message exchange provided by Ambassador Volker, we see evidence that Ukraine understood President Trump's demands loud and clear. On the morning of July 25th, half an hour before the infamous call between President Trump and President Zelensky, Ambassador Volker wrote to a senior Ukrainian official, heard from White House, assuming President Z convinces Trump he will investigate, get to the bottom of what happened in 2016, we will nail down date for visit to Washington. Good luck. See you tomorrow. Kurt. Ambassador Sondland confirmed that this text accurately summarized the president's directive to him earlier that morning. After the phone call between President Trump and President Zelensky, the Ukrainian official responded pointedly Phone call went well. He then discussed potential dates for a White House meeting. Then the very next day, Ambassador Volker wrote to Rudy Giuliani exactly the right messages as we discussed. These messages confirm Mr. Giuliani's central role, the premeditated nature of President Trump's solicitation of political investigation, and the pressure campaign on Ukraine waged by Mr. Giuliani and senior officials at President Trump's direction. Again, this is just some of what we learned from Ambassador Volker's records. As you will see during this trial presentation, there were numerous WhatsApp messages in August, while Ambassadors Volker and Sondland and Mr. Giuliani were pressuring President Zelensky's top aide to issue a statement announcing the investigations that President Trump wanted. And Ambassador Taylor's text that you saw earlier about withholding the aid further reveals how much more material there likely is that relates to the articles of impeachment. There can be no doubt that a full production of relevant texts and WhatsApp messages from other officials involved in Ukraine and in touch with Ukrainian officials, including Ambassador Sondland, Ambassador Taylor, and Deputy Assistant Secretary Kent, would further illuminate the malfeasance addressed in our first article. This leads to the second category of documents that the State Department is unlawfully withholding: emails involving key State Department officials concerning interactions with senior Ukrainian officials and relating to military aid, a White House meeting, and the president's demand for investigations into his rivals. For example, on July 19th, Ambassador Gordon Sondland spoke directly with President Zelensky about the upcoming July 25th call between President Trump and President Zelensky. Ambassador Sondland then sent an email updating key officials about Secretary Pompeo, including Secretary Pompeo, Acting White House Chief of Staff Mel Vaney, and his senior advisor Robert Blair. In this email, he noted that he prepared President Zelensky, who was willing to make the announcements of political investigations that President Trump desired. Secretary Perry and Mick Mulvaney then responded to Sondland, acknowledging they received the email and recommending to move forward with the phone call that became the July 25 call between the presidents of the United States and Ukraine. We know all of this not because the State Department provided us with critical document, but instead because Ambassador Sondland provided us a reproduction of the email. In his public testimony, Ambassador Sondland quite correctly explained that this email demonstrated, quote, everyone was in the loop.
Everyone was in the loop. It was no secret. Everyone was informed via email on July 19th, days before the presidential call. As I communicated to the team, I told President Zelensky in advance that assurances to run a fully transparent investigation and turn over every stone were necessary in his call with President Trump.
Even viewed alone, this reproduced email is damning. It was sent shortly after Ambassador Sondland personally conveyed the president's demand for investigations to Ukrainians at the White House, leading several officials to sound alarms. It was sent just a few days before the July 25 call, where President Trump asked for a favor. And by itself, this email shows who was embroiled in President Trump's plan to pressure the Ukrainian president for his own political gain. But it's obvious that the full email chain and other related emails to this key time period would also be highly relevant. We don't have those emails because the State Department is hiding them at the direction of the President. The Senate should issue the proposed subpoena to ensure a complete record of these and other relevant emails. Any doubt that the State Department is concealing critical evidence from this body was resolved when the State Department was recently ordered to release documents, including emails pursuant to a lawsuit under the Freedom of Information Act. These documents are heavily redacted and are limited to a very narrow time period. But nevertheless, despite the heavy redactions, these highly limited glimpses into the State Department's secret record demonstrates that those records are full of information relevant to this trial. For example, several of these newly elected or released emails show multiple contacts between the State Department, including Secretary Pompeo and Mr. Giuliani throughout 2019. This is an important fact. Mr. Giuliani served as the president's point person in executing his corrupt scheme. Mr. Giuliani repeatedly emphasized that his role was to advance the president's personal agenda, the president's political interests, not to promote the national security interest of the United States. The fact that the president's private attorney was in contact at key junctures with the Secretary of State, whose senior officials were directed by the president to support Mr. Giuliani's efforts in Ukraine, is relevant, disturbing, and telling. For example, we know that on March 26, as Mr. Giuliani was pursuing the president's private agenda in Ukraine, and just 1 week after The Hill published an article featuring Mr. Giuliani's Ukraine conspiracy theories, Secretary Pompeo and Mr. Giuliani spoke directly on the phone. That same week, President Trump's former personal secretary was asked by Mr. Giuliani's assistant for a direct connection to Secretary Pompeo. Based on these records, it is also clear that Secretary Pompeo was already actively engaged with Mr. Giuliani in early spring of 2019. And it also appears that these efforts were backed by the White House, given the involvement of President Trump's personal secretary. This body and the American people need to see these emails and other files at the State Department, fleshing out these exchanges and the details surrounding Mr. Giuliani's communications with Secretary Pompeo. Moreover, based on call records lawfully obtained by the House from this period, we know that from March 24th to March 30th, Mr. Giuliani called the White House several times and also connected with an unidentified number numerous times. These records show that on March 27th, Mr. Giuliani placed a series of calls to the State Department switchboard. Secretary Pompeo's assistant and the White House switchboard in quick succession, all within less than 30 minutes. Obtaining emails and other documents regarding the State Department's leadership's interaction with President Trump's private lawyer in this period, when Mr. Giuliani was actively orchestrating the pressure campaign in Ukraine related to the sham investigation into Vice President Biden and the 2016 election, would further clarify the president's involvement and direction at this key juncture in the formation of a plot to solicit foreign interference into our election. We also know, based on recently obtained documents, that Les Parmas, an associate of Rudy Giuliani, has assisted him in his representation of President Trump, that Giuliani likely spoke with Secretary Pompeo about Ukraine matters even earlier than previously understood. According to documents obtained from Mr. Parmas, Mr. Giuliani wrote in early February of 2019 that he apparently spoke with Secretary Pompeo about the removal of the U.S. ambassador in Ukraine, Marie Yovanovitch. Mr. Giuliani viewed her as an impediment to implementing the president's corrupt scheme and orchestrated a long-running smear campaign against her. Here's what Mr. Parma said about this just last week.
Do you believe that part of the motivation to get rid of Ambassador Yovanovitch, to get her out of post, was because she was in the way of this effort to get the government of Ukraine to announce investigations of Joe Biden?
That was the only motivation.
That was the only motivation.
There's no other motivation.
These are just some of the email communications that we know. These are just some of the email communications that we know to exist, but there are undoubtedly more, including, for example, Ambassador Yovanovitch requests for the State Department to issue a statement of support of her around the time that Mr. Giuliani was speaking directly with Secretary Pompeo. But that statement never came. The State Department has gathered these records and they are ready to be turned over pursuant to a subpoena from the Senate. It would not be a time-consuming or lengthy process to obtain them, and there are clearly important and relevant documents to the president's scheme. If we want the full and complete truth, then we need to see those emails. The Senate should also seek a third item that the State Department has refused to provide, and that's Ambassador Taylor's extraordinary first-person diplomatic cable to Secretary Pompeo, dated August 29, and sent at the recommendation of the National Security Advisor, John Bolton, in which Ambassador Taylor strenuously objected to the withholding of military aid from Ukraine, as Ambassador Taylor recounted in his deposition.
Near the end of Ambassador Bolton's visit, I asked to meet him privately, during which I expressed to him my serious concern about the withholding of military assistance to Ukraine while the Ukrainians were defending their country from Russian aggression. Ambassador Bolton recommended that I send a first-person cable to Secretary Pompeo directly, relaying my concerns. I wrote and transmitted such a cable on August 29th, describing the folly I saw in withholding military aid to Ukraine at a time when hostilities were still active in the East and when Russia was watching closely to gauge the level of American support for the Ukrainian government. The Russians, as I said at my deposition, would love to see the humiliation of President Zelensky at the hands of the Americans. I told the Secretary that I could not and would not defend such a policy. Although I received no specific response, I heard that soon thereafter, the Secretary carried the cable with him to a meeting at the White House focused on security assistance for Ukraine.
While we know from Ambassador Taylor and Deputy Assistant Secretary Kent that the cable was received, we do not know whether or how the State Department responded, nor do we know if the State Department possesses any other internal records relating to this cable. This cable is vital for three reasons. First, it demonstrates the harm that President Trump did to our national security when he used foreign policy as an instrument of his own personal political gain. Second, On the same day the cable was sent, President Zelensky's senior aide told Ambassador Taylor that he was very concerned about the hold on military assistance. He added that the Ukrainians were just desperate, added to be released. In other words, President Trump's effort to use military aid to apply additional pressure on Ukraine was working. And finally, based on reporting by the New York Times, we now know that within days of Ambassador Taylor sending this cable, President Trump discussed Ukrainian security assistance with Secretary Pompeo, Defense Secretary Esper, and National Security Advisor Bolton. The investigation uncovered testimony that Secretary Pompeo brought Ambassador Taylor's cable to the White House. Perhaps it was during this meeting. There, perhaps prodded by Ambassador Taylor's cable, all three of them pleaded with the president to resume the crucial military aid. Yet the president refused. This body has a right to see Ambassador Taylor's cable as well as the other State Department records addressing the official response to it. Although it may have been classified at the time, the State Department could no longer claim that the topic of security assistance remains classified today in light of the president's decision to declassify his two telephone calls with President Zelensky and Mr. Mulvaney's public statements about security assistance. The fourth category of documents that the Senate should subpoena are contemporaneous first-person accounts from State Department officials who were caught up in President Trump's corrupt scheme. These documents, which were described in detail by Deputy Assistant Secretary Kent, Ambassador Taylor, and the political officer David Holmes, would help complete the record and clarify how the president's scheme unfolded in real time and how the Ukrainians reacted. Mr. Kent wrote notes or memos to file at least four times, according to his testimony. Ambassador Taylor took extensive notes of nearly every conversation he had, some in a little notebook. And David Holmes, the embassy official in Ukraine, was a consistent note taker of important meetings with Ukrainian officials.
Did you take notes of this conversation on September 1st with Ambassador Sondland?
I did.
And did you take notes related to most of the conversations, if not all of them, that you recited in your opening statement?
All of them, Mr. Goldman.
And you are aware, I presume, that the State Department has not provided those notes to the committee, is that right?
I am aware.
So we don't have the benefit of reviewing them to ask you these questions?
Correct. I understand that they may be coming sooner or later.
Well, we would welcome that.
The State Department never produced those notes. As another example, Deputy Assistant Secretary Kent testified about a key document that he drafted on August 16th, describing his concerns that the Trump administration was attempting to pressure Ukraine into opening politically motivated investigations.
I'd like to start with you, Mr. Kent. In your testimony, you said that you had, in mid-August, it became clear to me that Giuliani's efforts to gin up politically motivated investigations were now infecting U.S. engagement with Ukraine, leveraging President Zelensky's desire for a White House meeting. Mr. Kent, did you actually write a memo documenting your concerns that there was an effort underway to pressure Ukraine to open an investigation to benefit President Trump?
Yes, ma'am. I wrote a memo to the file on August 16th.
But we don't have access to that memo, do we?
I submitted it to the State Department subject to the September 27th subpoena.
And we have not received one piece of paper from the State Department relative to this investigation.
Deputy Assistant Secretary Kent also memorialized a September 15 conversation at which Ambassador Taylor described a Ukrainian official accusing America of hypocrisy for advising President Zelensky against investigating a prior Ukrainian president. Mr. Kent described that conversation during his testimony. He said, but the more awkward part of the conversation came after Special Representative Volker made the point that the Ukrainians, who had opened their authorities under President Zelensky, had opened investigations of former President Poroshenko. He didn't think that was appropriate. And then Andrei Yermak said, what? You mean the type of investigations you're pushing for us to do on Biden and Clinton? The conversation makes clear the Ukrainian officials understood the corrupt nature of President Trump's requests and therefore doubted American credibility on anti-corruption measures. Records of these conversations and other notes and memoranda by senior American officials in Ukraine would flesh out and help complete the record for the first article of impeachment. They would tell the whole truth and to the American people and to this body. You should require the State Department to provide them. To summarize, the Senate should issue the subpoena proposed in the amendment requiring the State Department to turn over relevant texts and WhatsApp messages, emails, diplomatic cables, and notes. These documents bear directly on the trial of this body, the trial that this body is required by the Constitution to hold. They are immediately relevant to the first article of impeachment. Their existence has been attested to by credible witnesses in the House. And the only reason we don't already have them is that the president has ordered his administration, including Secretary Pompeo, to hide them. The president's lawyers may suggest that the House should have sought these materials in court or awaited further lawsuits under the Freedom of Information Act, aka FOIA lawsuits. Any such suggestion is meritless. To start, the Constitution has never been understood to require such lawsuits, which has never occurred. It's never occurred in any previous impeachment. Moreover, the president has repeatedly and strenuously argued that the House is not even allowed to file a suit to enforce its subpoenas. And in the Freedom of Information Act cases, the administration has only grudgingly and slowly produced an extremely small set of materials, but has insisted on applying heavy and dubious redactions. FOIA lawsuits filed by third parties cannot serve as a credible alternative to congressional oversight. In fact, it is still alarming that the administration has produced more documents pursuant to the Federal Office of Information Act lawsuits by private citizens and entities than congressional subpoenas. Finally, as we all know, litigation would take an extremely long time, likely years, not weeks or months, while the misconduct of this president requires immediate attention. The misconduct of this president requires immediate attention if this body is truly committed to a fair trial. It cannot let the president play a game of keep away and dictate what evidence the senators can and cannot see bearing on his guilt or innocence. This body cannot permit him to hide all the evidence while disingenuously insisting on lawsuits that he doesn't actually think we can file, ones that he knows won't be resolved until after the election he is trying to cheat to win. Instead, to honor your oaths to do impartial justice, we urge each senator to support a subpoena to the State Department. And that subpoena should be issued now, at the beginning of the trial, rather than at the end, so these documents can be reviewed and their importance weighed by the parties, the Senate, and by the American people. That is how things work in every courtroom in the nation. And it is how they should work here, especially because the stakes, as you all know, are so high. The truth is there. Facts are stubborn things. The president is trying to hide it. This body should not surrender to his obstruction by refusing to demand a full record. That is why the House managers support this amendment. And Mr. Chief Justice, the House managers reserve the balance of our time.